For example, there's such a powerful destiny upon her life and her future. What is it that will unfold in this year that will see that come to pass in your life? So the Lord gave me a scripture even before Pastor Josie asked me to share. The Lord revealed this scripture to me. It's in Joshua chapter 7 and verse 19. You can put it up on the back there. Joshua chapter 7 and verse 19. So Joshua chapter 7 is really the story of Achan. So what happens is the children of Israel, which is really a type of the church, they often engaged in battles, and then in some battles, the Lord would say to them, you may not touch anything. You may not touch the gold, the silver, you may not take the wives, you touch nothing. But in other battles, he would say to them, you know what? All of the spoils of battle are yours. Take the whole lot. So in 2016, what is God saying for you? Is this spoil of battle for you? Or is this one not for you? So oftentimes, we want to take the spoil of battle because we're scared the next one might not be for us, and the next one might, because we don't have a revelation of God's goodness, that He actually has our best interest at heart. So we find ourselves pursuing things that He actually said we ought not to touch. How many of you are here today? So then we get in Joshua chapter 7 verse 19. Joshua said to Achan, my son, give glory to the Lord. How many of you here want to give glory to the Lord?
Amen.
We've heard so much teaching, and it's been powerful teaching on the revelation of the glory in this church. What does it say? Give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, and give Him the praise. So what do we do now? Tell me what you have done. Do not hide it from me. In other words, if you want to give glory to the Lord, you have to tell what you have done and not hide it. So last time I ministered, we spoke about the splinter. Any of you remember the splinter? We spoke about the water inside the bottle. So this sin that's in me, it's not me, it's the sin. It's the splinter. It's the thing in me that holds me in bondage, that keeps me bound. And then we talked about there being layers of the onion. So every time you dig deeper, you find more stuff in the layer that needs to be exposed to God. So here he says, give glory to the Lord. Tell me what you've done. Do not hide it from me. You know, sometimes it's painful to open up and expose those tender parts of our heart because it comes from real sad moments that one feels broken, that one doesn't want to open up, doesn't want to expose. But in order to give God glory, you have to allow Him to open up those layers of the onion. Verse 21. This is what Achan now says. He says, when I saw the plunder, a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver, a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. They are hidden in the ground in my tent, and the silver is underneath. So what happens is we see this idea that we're going to drive this new BMW, and all we have is this idea of the flesh. It's a natural thing that we're after. It's not something that God has given us the spoils of war, but it's our secular, it's our way of being higher, being better, being something other than what we actually are. It's losing that authenticity that John Lennon spoke about. We want to be authentic, get down to the real, real, real me. So this is what he did. He took that stuff and then he went and hid it under the tent. Because you can't enjoy those spoils because they're not meant for you. Somebody said, that's not meant for me. But there is something that God has meant for you. But that's not it. So today we have to begin to understand what is for me. What is for me? The word says that he coveted them and took them. What are we coveting today that's not of God? So in verse 24, Let's go there and read it on the screen. Verse 24. It says, then Joshua took together with all Israel. They took Achan, the son of Zerah. They took the silver, the robe, the gold. They took his sons, they took his daughters, his cattle, his donkeys and sheep and his tent, and all that he had to the valley of Achor. So when you pursue things that are not for you, you get found with things that don't belong to you, and you really received them because you coveted them, which is not a godly thing. It's coming out of the natural self. So today I want to teach you really about understanding what is it that we really after. That's real success. That's authentic success. That takes us from one level of glory to another level of glory. So what I did is I studied that word Achor. And Achor basically means it's a valley near Jericho, but it's called Achor in a consequence to the trouble of the sin which Achan caused Israel. So here we have a valley, it's actually a real place, but it's a consequence of trouble. So how many of you have had consequences in your life? Somebody say consequences. To decisions that you've made, to things that you've done, there's a consequence. So, how many of you know that when you find yourself in a state of consequence, God doesn't leave you there? So in 2016, 2015 might have even been the worst year of your life. It doesn't matter to God. What matters to God is not where you come from. What matters to God is where you are going. So Achor is a place where there's a consequence of your sin. But that same word Achor, a little bit later on, you go to Isaiah, and Isaiah in Isaiah 65 and verse 10. Isaiah uses the same word Achor, and he uses it as a place for the herds to lie down. In other words, that which has been a source of calamity in your life would become a source of blessing. Sharon will become a pasture for flocks, and the valley of Achor a resting place for herds, for my people who seek me. So the very valley that was a consequence of your life will become a very resting place for you, for your herds, for your family, for success, for you to prosper, for you to be fulfilled in the destiny of your life. But you know God, he always likes to have a witness of two or three. So he goes further and he goes to Hosea chapter 2 verse 15. Hosea chapter 2 and verse 15. Hosea uses the expression in the same sense. But he says trouble would be turned into joy. Despair into hope. Verse 15 and 16 says, there will I give her back to her vineyards, and will make the valley of Achor a door of hope. How many of you want a door of hope in 2016? So the very valley of consequence is the very door of hope in your life. This is the God that we serve. There she will sing as the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of Egypt. Was it not a great day when the children of Israel came out? Even in the midst of the very consequence of your sin, God creates something that gives you a door into a 2016 that will not be mocked in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In that day, declares the Lord, you will call me my husband. You will no longer call me my master. Do you know that in other translations, you may have it in your Bible, that says you will no longer call me Ishi, thou shalt call me Bali. And what that really means is you will call me husband and no longer master or lord. And thus ye shall serve me out of love, not out of fear. You see, Ishi denotes marriage and youthful love. Isn't it so beautiful when you watch the youthful love of the patients in holiday there, enjoying each other? I'm picking on them today. It speaks of youthful love. And it doesn't speak of lordship and fear. So when we're dealing with the valley of Achor, we're not dealing with a God who rules us and judges us with a rod of iron, but we're dealing with a love relationship that will woo us into a time of intimacy. What did we say the glory? The glory was when the guy was willing to open up. Do you know what real intimacy is? When somebody opens up, they open their life. Would you be willing to open your life to Jesus? Let me take you a bit deeper. Put up slide number one for me if you can. Slide number one is the scripture in Romans chapter 10 verse 13. Now, if you look at it, you'll see it's all kinds of gobbledygook, but what it's doing is, it's telling you, then it says, for, past God, whosoever. So, for is the English version, past God, that's the Greek and the Hebrew original words next to it. So, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Okay, so when we say who shall call upon the Lord, that word call upon is epikalamaia. Alright, so if you see 1941 epikalamaia, 1941 is the Greek reference to that word. So the Greek reference to that word, if you look down here, it says by implication to invoke. For aid, worship, testimony, decision, to invoke. And it comes from a root word, 1909. So in other words, the Bible says, if you call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be what?
Saved.
Somebody say saved. So now we say, you know, I know lots of people that called on God and begged God, and I myself called and begged God. I was in trouble, and you know what I got? Nothing. So how does that work out? I'm going to explain it to you. So the word epikalamaio, to call upon the Lord, is actually a word that says invoke. Go to the next slide. Invoke is a verb, it's a doing word. It means to cite or to appeal to someone or something as an authority for action. It's not just a dialogue, we're not just having a discussion or a debate. This is to invoke something from God. When our pastor Desiree stood up this morning, she invoked something from God. She said, I need you, Lord. I need you. I need you right now, Lord. I need you now. It's invoking the presence of God into our environment. Somebody said amen.
Amen.
So, in other words, to call upon the name of the Lord, it's a legal term. It really means to call for action. And it actually even says call on a deity or a spirit. Let's go to the next slide. Just go back to slide number one quickly. Slide number one. Okay, so there it says, it's from 1909. So whenever you see a word, they tell you what the root of that is. So this word to call upon is from a root of 1909. And that 1909 word, okay, go to number three now. So 1909 is the root word, and that is a primary preposition, properly meaning superimposition of time, of place, of order, as a relation of distribution. In other words, I over upon. So when I say I'm calling upon the name of the Lord, what I'm really saying is that I'm superimposing the word of God upon a circumstance, upon an environment, upon a place, upon a time, upon a destiny. I'm superimposing the word of God onto that thing. When I superimpose the word of God with an expectation that I invoke that word, that's more than just calling on the Lord. Lord, I need help. That's not calling on the Lord, because there's no understanding in that of what I'm really calling upon. It's a legal term that says I superimpose over my life the word of God. So how many of you face a challenge and all of a sudden you got fear, doubt, and unbelief because something came toward you that had the potential to destroy your life or to be bad news? In that moment, Pastor Josie talks about discern the moment. In that moment, you have an opportunity to decide, do I invoke the word, or do I settle for what the devil wants to do in my life? Do I settle for where I come from? Do I settle for all of that stuff, or do I invoke the word of God? Superimpose the word of God. Next slide, please. So, Matthew 7:21 says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, will inherit the kingdom of heaven. So if I call upon the Lord, I'm not inheriting that kingdom. If I'm one of those, not everyone. Is that right? And that word said is the word lego. And the word doeth is the word web. So in other words, not everyone that lego will get it, but everyone that poyo will get it. So let's go look. Next slide. What does lego mean? The word lego is a primary verb again. It means to relate. It means to have discourse. It means let's have a chat. Let's sit down and have tea. Let's talk about it. How many of you like to talk about your problems? How many like to talk about what went wrong, where you came from, what all the difficulties are? How many like to talk about the mountain? The Bible didn't say talk about your mountain, it said talk to your mountain. So to just ask somebody in a systematic set of discourse will not give you any results in 2016. Let's look at the next verse, the next slide. The word doeth, poyo, is a prolonged form of an obsolete primary to make or to do. In other words, really, if you look at the red there, it says to execute. It says to exercise, to fulfill. In other words, it's talking about the same thing we said to superimpose. In other words, place that expectation. So when I say I'm a doer of the word, it means I'm imposing the word, I'm placing an expectation on the word, I'm stepping into the revelation of the realm of the spirit and the dimension where God moves, and I'm not just having an idle discourse. Are you learning something? So it's not just about discourse. The next slide, number 7. In short, the Bible says the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violent take it by? Somebody say force. In other words, you place that expectation. You settle that thing, you grab a hold of that thing, you do something with that thing. It's not just a discourse. We don't sit around and ask, God has already given us all things that pertain to life and godliness, and now it's up to us. So then I was looking at these things, and the Lord gave me a revelation. This was pretty powerful. Put up the next slide, number 8. It's Matthew 12, verse 33. A tree is identified by its fruit. If a tree is good, its fruit will be good. If a tree is bad, its fruit will be bad. You brood of snakes. Any snakes here? How can evil men speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart determines what you say. Today, the title of this message is Victory for 2016. So can I teach you how to get victory? What I say is what's in my heart. So if I want to change what's in my heart, which is really in my life, I have to change what I say. So the key to unlocking your future is tied together with what you say. Verse 36, I tell you, on the day of judgment, men will give an account for every idle word, every useless word, every inoperative word, or every non-working word. So if I say something that's not producing, it's inoperative. If I say something that I already have, it's not producing. I already have it. In other words, if I say something that's not stretching the boundary, then I'm going to give an account because it's an inoperative, it's a non-working word. For For by my words I will be justified and acquitted, and by my words I will be condemned and sentenced, whether I am innocent or guilty. When we got saved, it was by our words. We believe in our heart and speak with our mouth, and so we are saved. So our whole life, that is the very starting foundation, basis point of our life. But we take it from there and we go forward. So when we go forward, we say everything in life has to be on the same principle. We have to believe in our heart and declare with our mouth, with an expectation and invoking the rights and the legal understanding of who Christ is into our circumstance, into our environment. A non-working word is not straining towards something that's bigger, something that's better, something that's in God's heart for your life. Trevor posted a nice picture on WhatsApp group about growth. Do you know that a growth is something that grows in your body or on your body? It's something that takes up more space. To grow is something bigger than the capacity that you currently have. It's something bigger than who you are. How many would like to see Kim grow bigger than what she is? How many of you like to see her have greater capacity than what she is? She may hold the capacity right now, but do you know God doesn't want her to stay the way she is? Do you know God doesn't want you to stay the way you are? He wants us to grow. So, let me tell you this. Have you ever heard of abracadabra? In New Year's Eve, there's more abracadabras than we want, because we say, abracadabra, I'm going to be this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to abracadabra. You know why we say abracadabra? Because we fail to understand the power of the living Christ that leads us in a divine destiny and a divine moment for our future. Put up that slide for me, abracadabra. Abracadabra, actually an Armenian or Hebrew phrase, means I create what I speak. Do you know that the devil is not creative? The devil cannot create something. All he can do is counterfeit. Somebody say counterfeit. So when you find the devil with his magic, you know that's a counterfeit. So if that be the counterfeit, what is the real? The real is that I take with my words and I create something that I am speaking. In 2016, you can have what you say. Lord have mercy on us. Okay, this is going to be powerful. Are you ready for this? Densley was supposed to help me, now he's not here, so I asked this brother over here to come help. Come and help me, brother.
Can somebody put this podium just down?
Has anybody been to a dance-off? Today, we're going to have a dance-off. So this is going to be trouble. All right. Show me what you got. Give me some moves. Show me if you're cool. Do you think you're better than me? Do you think? Come on, bro. Give me some beat there, bro.
Go!
praised for victory. Anybody here watch cricket? We had such a vavoom. It was unbelievable. Vavoom did a knock. But you know how difficult it was for South Africa? When England had 650 on the board. When you look at 2016, others around about you might have 630 on the board. But life is a dance. It's about confidence. Do you have confidence in the God that you serve or not? Because Amla had to throw off his captaincy. Because it wasn't his destiny. He had to pursue what was his destiny, and that's to be the number one player to score those runs against all of that resistance. Somebody say resistance. Do you know that there will be resistance? But in the resistance, you have to stand and face with full assurance and confidence that God is on your side. Confidence. The Bible says, cast not away your... Somebody say confidence. So when we look at this, the very reason of our sin gave us anchor. But the very anchor became the very door to our destiny. Because the God that's in us is for us. And he's a good God. So when I begin to speak, not with dialogue, not with discussion, not talking about what has been, but talking about a God who's more than enough to take me where I've never been before. To enlarge the capacity of my dead. To stretch me. How many of you, you know, Trevor, we sat down and had a long discussion about his new business venture. I think I gave him every reason in the book not to do it. But how many of you see Trevor later? He's like the king of the castle, man. He's moving in a different dimension. Do you know why? Because, like they spoke earlier, we need each other. What did he say? That was so powerful. When we come together, we support each other. You know what? He associated himself with a brand, and in his mind, he believes that brand is going to bring him success. So now, he feels like you can say what you like. I'm connected with a brand. So I told him he could have done it on his own. But you know, the point is, he found reference in that point of contact. And that point of contact gave him confidence. And when you have confidence, you can walk with your head full, with your shoulders. Come on, no other agent in town can come against you, can touch you, can short. Nobody can do it because confidence. Where did you place your confidence? How many of you seen God? What a boy, man. C8. Somebody say C8. He connected himself with some go-getters. And you know what he's become? Go-getter. I mean, what a powerful word he just put. See how I am. How many of you want to be like that? I want to be like you. I want to be able to do more. I want to be able to stretch from where I was. You know, history limits you to your past. History limits you to what the mindset is. You can even talk a bit about the whole racism thing that's going on at the moment. It's such a mess up. But you know what? One can be caught up in the past, or one can decide, I have to grow. I have to grow bigger. Because in life, the devil wants to keep you bound in your yesterday with a connection to a memory. And what we have to do is, in other words, we have to change what we say in order to change who we are. The fruit of the tree can't be good, and you can't have a good environment in your life and say yesterday's bad things. Oh, come here, brother. Hallelujah, that God's sorted me out for a few minutes. Okay. All right, I want you to call. Okay. Pastor Joseph. called him. So there's a difference between calling somebody or calling something or calling. Because I call you blessed. I call you anointed man of God, instrument, vessel that God has ordained for revival in the southern tip of Africa and beyond. I call you an anointed instrument of God that heaven has prepared before the foundation of the earth for such a moment as this. I call you a mighty man of God. I call you blessed. When Adam was placed in the earth, God said to him, here's all of the animals, all of everything. You name it. Whatever you name it, that is what it shall be called. So when you call somebody, when we call upon the name of the Lord, it's not dialogue. It's not dialogue. It's to invoke the anointing of the living Christ onto an environment, onto a person, onto a circumstance, onto something that you want to see unfold in 2016 in your life. Whatever he called them, that's what they were named. Who's our example if it be not God? God said in Genesis chapter 1, like me. Sea bee, firmament bee, all of these bees. And God said, somebody said, God said, if I am created in his image, I said the other day, I'm a bit bald here because I'm in the image of God and God's been tearing his hair out of the church age. So. If God said it, who are we not to say it?
Come on, man.
With the same degree of expectation that whatever we say, it will be. Because he said, like me, and it. Somebody said it was. God spoke over Abraham. Said to you, Abraham, you are the father of many nations. The word says, shall I declare this to Abraham, since this is what he shall be? Shall I declare this to my circumstance, since this is what it shall be? In other words, if I am not invoking something, it's powerless. But if I invoke it, since I am declaring this, it is because it shall be. What can you declare over your life? In 2016, that shall be. And we have to be so careful because we always want to declare those things that we attach ourselves with in the natural. I use the term BMW because everybody can understand it. But when we align ourselves with what is God doing? What is it that's meant for me? What is my spoils of war? Because some spoils, he has said, do not touch it. And then we pursue it, we get ourselves into debt, and then we're driving with debt on our shoulders, and it's like that silver that's under the tent, under the ground. Nobody can even see it because we're bound by it. But there's spoils of war if we align ourselves to what God is doing and saying and has released from us. Because this is about building the kingdom of God. When we align ourselves and build the kingdom of God, everything else is added. He doesn't take those things away from us. He gives them to us, but in his time, in his appointed moment at the divine place. Scripture says God doesn't do nothing except he first reveals it through the prophets. Somebody must say something. We always used to use that analogy that you got to do what you can do and then God can do what you can't do, the supernatural. But do you know that by saying that we leave everything up to God? But he's already done everything he's going to do. He's not coming back to the cross a second time. He's already sacrificed his life for everything. It's up to us now to lay a hold of that for which Christ has laid a hold of us for, and get a hold of that and move into the dimension of that perfect will and anointing and pleasure of God. us back many times is, and Pastor Josie's talked about it so beautifully, is the memory. Do you know, Pastor Josie never mentioned it, but do you know that a memory passes down even through your DNA? They have proven that what's happened to your great-great-great-great-grandfather affects your emotions, and you have no even understanding why. You may dislike something, and you don't even know why, but it can be that 3 or 4 generations ago, somebody in your family had a bad experience. You may find that your great-great-grandmother was raped, and you have a very difficult time in relationships, and you don't understand why, because in your DNA is a memory that's associated with relationship with pain. This is scientifically proven. So when we talk about racism, we talk about slavery, we talk about stuff that runs so deep, even if it's nothing that you experience yourself, it will run in your DNA, and when something arises, you can't even understand why there's such a high level of emotion. Because there's an attachment to the memory. How does the devil take and destroy our life if it's not an attachment to the memory? Do you know that in psychology, I was even listening, it was on the radio this week. They are now working on ways to remove the emotional element from a memory. Because a memory in itself is not what destroys your life. It's the emotional attachment that goes with it. So let me give you a very clear example. Probably most of you ladies have been for a pap smear. And you happily go to the doctor, have a pap smear, and go home. There's no emotional trauma to your life. But in a rape, it's very similar to that story. Somebody is touching your body in a similar way. The difference is that there's an emotional attachment. So if you're raped, most people that are raped, they struggle for the rest of their life just about trying to conquer that emotion in their memory. And yet women go to the doctor all the time for their pap smear once a year, they go. Because there's a connection to the memory. Do you know? My grandmother used to cut the top of the chicken off before she put it in the oven. And now my mother does the same thing. She cuts the top of the chicken. I said, "Mom, why do you cut the top of the chicken?" She says, "I don't know, it was Granny did it." So we went to Granny. "Granny, why did you cut the top of the chicken?" "No, because we had an oven that was too low." There may be some low ovens in your memory that are causing you to live your life out of emotion. When we talk about invoking the very life of Christ, you see, what we're talking about is speaking the Word. The Word has a name. Joy has a name. Peace has a name. What else? Love has a name. And if they're words for it, I don't have that. Because what? Give me the next line. They're words for it, then I don't have that. Just give me a few lines. Come on. You're on the spot. If they're words for him, I don't have them. Because love has a name. It's not about empty. It's not about me trying to think of something. I can't in my capacity declare who he is. He's bigger than me. But Jesus is the Word. So when we get a revelation of Jesus, When we're talking about superimposing the word, we're not superimposing some little Norman Vincent Peale positive prose speaking that you heard some, at some sales meeting. Yeah. We're talking about superimposing Christ, the very source of our DNA that we have memory of Him. 2016. There's so many scriptures. And to bring the glory of God, we saw the scripture and said, we have to open up those things. We're willing to open up some things today and start to begin to declare the Christ over your life. Is there somebody that's willing to do that? The Bible says we overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the Word. That Word is not a Norman that's appealed something. The Word of the living Christ. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us so that we can have intimacy with that Word. Do you know, there's so many things we can cover for 2016, but this body of believers will seek after the Christ.
Amen.
This body of believers will have a dimension of 2060. Can you imagine if you can begin to declare Christ over your year? Declare Christ over your family. Declare Christ over your business. Declare Christ over your motor car. Declare Christ over every circumstance. In alignment, not looking for those things that He said not to touch, but waiting for the moment when He releases what is mine to me. Making a declaration with my mouth and conquering the violent, take it by force, and we will not cast away our confidence in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Do you want to read that part? Do you want to read it? Okay. Let's let her read it because it's so powerful.
If there are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my brain has not reached the point where it could form a thought that could adequately describe the greatness of my God. And my lungs have not developed the ability to release a breath with enough agility to breathe out the greatness of His love. And my voice is so inhibited, restricted by human limits, that it's hard to even send a praise up. If there are words for him, then I don't have them. My God. His grace is remarkable, mercies innumerable, strength impenetrable. He's undefinable, yet approachable, indescribable, yet personal. He's beyond comprehension, further than imagination, constant through generations, King of every nation. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. You see, my words are few, and to try and capture the one true God using my vocabulary will never do. But I use my words as an expression of worship to a Savior who's both worthy and deserving of my praise. So I use words. My heart extols the Lord, blesses His name forever. He has won my heart, captured my mind, and bound them both together. He has defeated me in my rebellion, has conquered me in my sin. He has welcomed me into His presence, completely invited me in. He has made Himself the object of my sight, flooding me with mercies in the morning and drowning me with grace in the night. But if there are words for him, then I don't have them. But what I do have is good news. For my God knew that man-made words would never do. For words are just tools that we use to point to the truth. So he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, as the Word, living proof. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, giving nothingness formation. And by his word he sustains in the power of his name. For he is before things and over all things he reigns. Holy is his name. Praise him for his life, the way he persevered in strife, the humble Son of God becoming the perfect sacrifice. Praise him for his death, that he willingly stood in our place, that he lovingly endured the grave, that he battled our enemy and on the third day arose in victory. Praise him because he rose. Hallelujah, he rose. He is everything that was promised. Praise him as the risen King. Lift your voice and sing. For one day he will return for us and we will finally be united with our Savior for eternity. So it's just not words that I proclaim. For my words point to the Word, and the Word has a name. Hope has a name. Joy has a name. Peace has a name. Love has a name. And that name is Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ. So now, Carl spoke about the Jewish way of doing things. One of the things that the Jews do is they bless their people. They have Shabbat every Friday night and they sit around a table, and what the Father does is he puts his hand on their head and blesses them. He blesses them. And today I felt it prudent for us to invite Pastor Josie to put a word in his mouth to speak a blessing over us as a people. Are you ready to receive a word of blessing? What you want to do is you want to take your words and invoke something. It's a legal requirement. It's an expectation that this is backed up by the governance of law. And so we want to invite Pastor Josie.